If anyone holds sorrow in his spirit from fresh grief and is dried out in his heart from grieving, the singer, servant of the muses, hymns the deeds of men of the past and the blessed gods who hold Olympus, and right away he forgets his troubles and does not remember a single care. Quickly do the gifts of the goddess divert him. Hail, children of Zeus, and give your song that excites desire. Celebrate the holy race of immortals who are for always, those born from Gaia and starry Ouranos, and Dark Night, and those whom salty Pontos bore. Tell how the gods and Gaia first came into being, and the rivers and the boundless sea raging with swell, and the shining stars and wide Ouranos above, and how they divided the wealth and apportioned provinces. Also how they first came to hold Olympus of many glens. Tell me these things, muses who hold your halls in Olympus. Rhea, subdued by Cronos, bore illustrious children, Hestia and Demeter, and golden-sandaled Hera, and mighty Hades, who dwells in houses beneath the earth, having a pitiless heart, and loud rumbling Earthshaker, and Zeus of counsels, father of gods and men, beneath whose thunder the wide earth quivers. Great Cronos kept swallowing them as each arrived at his mother's knees from her sacred womb, intending that no other one of the illustrious children of Ouranos hold the kingly province among the immortals. For he learned from Gaia and starry Ouranos that it was fated for him to be subdued by his son, although he himself was powerful, through the plans of great Zeus. Therefore he kept no blind vigilance, but awaiting each, he would swallow his children. But Rhea had pain not to be forgotten. But when she was about to bear Zeus, father of gods and men, she beseeched her parents, Gaia and starry Ouranos, to contrive a scheme so that she might give birth to her son in secret, and make great Cronos of crooked counsel pay her father's avenging fury, and that of the children he swallowed. They listened to their daughter and obeyed, and informed her what was fated to happen for Cronos, king and powerful-hearted son. They sent Rhea to Lyctos, to the fat country of Crete, when she was about to give birth to the last of her children, great Zeus. Monstrous Gaia received him in broad Crete to nourish and foster. There she arrived, carrying him through the swift black night, first to Lyctos. Holding him in her arms, she hid him in a high cave, beneath the ways of divine Gaia, on densely wooded Mount Igaeon. She wrapped a stone in swaddling clothes, entrusted it to Ouranos' son and great lord, king of gods, before he took it down into his womb, cruel one. And he did not realize it in his mind, so that in return for a stone, his son remained unconquered and unconcerned, who was going to subdue him by brute force in his hands and drive him from his province and lord among the immortals. Rapidly the strength and the limbs and their glory of the Lord grew, and when the year in its cycle came around, deceived by Gaia's sagacious advice, Cronos of crooked counsel sent up his offspring again, conquered by the schemes and brute force of his son. He vomited the stone first, swallowing it last, and it Zeus fixed in the broad-wayed earth, and hollowed Pytho beneath the veils of Parnassos, to be a sign hereafter, a wonder for mortal men. He loosened his father's brothers from destructive bonds, sons of Ouranos, whom their father bound in his folly. They remembered gratitude for his benefactions and gave him thunder, and gleaming lightning, and flash, before monstrous Gaia hid them, relying upon these Zeus lords over mortals and immortals. When first father Ouranos was angered in his spirit at Opriaris and Kotos and Gyges, he bound them in evil chains, envying their excessive manhood and shape and size. He settled them beneath broad-wayed earth. There, dwelling beneath the earth in pain, they sat at the farthest ends of the limits of great Gaia, grieving deeply and having great sorrow in their heart. But Cronides and the other immortal gods, whom beautiful-haired Rhea bore in Philotes with Cronos, in accord with Gaia's advice, brought them into the light again. She herself recounted for them everything in clear fashion. With them, they would win victory and vaunt of renown. For all too long they had been fighting with toil that pains his spirit against one another in strong encounters, the Titan gods and those born of Cronos. The illustrious Titans from lofty Orthrios, and from Olympus the gods, giver of good things, those whom beautiful-haired Rhea bore after being bedded by Cronos. They had battles against one another that bring pain to the spirit, constantly battling for 10 full years. No loosening of harsh strife was there or end for either side, and the decision of war was pulled fast and even. But when Zeus supplied them with what they needed, nectar and ambrosia, things gods themselves eat, their manly spirit grew in the breasts of them all. Then to them spoke the father of men and gods. Hear me, brilliant children of Gaia and Ouranos, that I may say what the spirit in my breast bids me. Already now for too long against one another for victory and power we have been fighting all days. The Titan gods and those of us born from Kronos. You reveal your great brute force and untouchable hands to the Titans, opposing them in dire fray. Remember kind Philotes and what you suffered before you came into the light again from bondage, from the murky darkness in accord with our plans. Thus Zeus spoke and blameless Kotos answered him. Strange one, you do not reveal what is unknown. But we ourselves know that your mind is superior and your purpose. And you are the defender for the immortals against icy cold harm. And by your advice from the gloomy darkness and harsh chains we have come back again, Lord Son of Kronos, having suffered the unexpected. Now with stubborn mind and a ready spirit, we will defend your power in dread battle strife, fighting against the Titans in strong encounters.
So spoke Kotos, and the gods, giver of good things, heard and praised his words. Their spirit craved war even more than before. They moved wretched battle, all of them, females and males, on that day. Titan gods and those who were born from Kronos and those whom Zeus from Erebos beneath the earth brought into light. These were dreadful and strong, possessing excessive force. 100 arms shot forth from their shoulders for all of them alike, and each had 50 heads grown out from their shoulders on sturdy limbs. Then they settled themselves against the Titans in the dire fray, holding huge rocks in their sturdy hands. From the other side, the Titans strengthened their ranks eagerly, and both sides were revealing the works of forceful hands, and the boundless sea resounded dreadfully, and the earth screamed loudly, and wide Ornos groaned when heaved, and from the foundations lofty Olympus shook beneath the fury of the immortals. The heavy pounding of their feet reached murky Tartarus, as did the shrill screams of the terrible pursuit and powerful missiles. Thus they hurled mournful darts at one another. The sound of both reached starry Ornos as they cried out. No longer did Zeus restrain his might, but straightway his heart filled with might, and he showed all his brute force. Ornos and Olympus together he came striding, flashing lightning constantly. His bolts were flying in close array with thunder and flash from his sturdy hands, whirling the flame thickly. Life-bearing Gaia screamed as she burned, and the immense forest crackled loudly all around. All the earth was boiling, as well as the streams of Ornos and the unplowed sea. Hot blasts encompassed the nether Titans, and immense flame reached the shining ether. Although the Titans were stalwart, the gleaming light of the lightning and flash deprived them of their eyes. Ineffable heat gripped chaos. It seemed to the eyes for the seeing and the ears for the hearing exactly as if Gaia and wide Ornos from above were drawing near one another. Such a loud din would rise up with Gaia being fallen upon and Ornos falling from above. Such was the din that sounded as the gods clashed in strife. The winds produced shaking and whipped up dust, and abetted thunder and flashing and gleaming lightning, shafts of great Zeus. They carried swift uproar and clamor into the midst of both sides. A terrible din arose from their dreadful wrath, and the work of power was revealed, battle and climb. Before, they had launched at one another and battled constantly through strong encounters. Then, among the foremost, they aroused bitter strife, Kotos and Briaros and Gyges, insatiate of war. 300 rocks from their sturdy hands they were hurling, one on another, and they cast shadows over the Titans with missiles. They sent them beneath broad-wayed earth and bound them in painful bonds, having conquered them by hands though they were bold. As far beneath the earth as Ornos is above Gaia, so far from earth to murky Tartarus.